So yesterday we have seen a lot about DMA controller. So today let us see the DMA transfer. So in this DMA transfer also, yesterday we have seen going to this figure, and several things we discussed here. Several things we discussed means how this is this bus read control, write control, data bus, address bus. All these lines together is a memory bus. This memory bus, why we are calling memory bus? Because this is, these wires are connected to this memory. That's why we are calling it a memory bus. Now what is that happening is, this memory bus, earlier it was having control by CPU only. That's why this I/O device needs to directly communicate to the CPU, or CPU has to check the whether I/O device wants to communicate, and then the CPU should give this data if I/O device wants. If I/O device wants to write, then it has to facilitate even write facility. Who is doing all that? CPU. So now what we are doing is, we are releasing from the job of controlling, data transfer job from memory to I/O, I/O to memory. So releasing and giving that job to this DMA controller. That's why this DMA controller also has got read, write, address, data. All that are connected to memory bus. Memory bus means all these signals are memory bus. So how is that happening and all? We have seen in a DMA controller. Here, this DMA, where is that DMA controller? This one, DMA controller. Here we have seen, yesterday we discussed elaborately what is that everything happening, why this address register, why this hold count register, why control register, what is that request happening, what is that bus request, bus grant, why this interrupt is, everything yesterday we have seen. And those who want to revise, already recorded video is there on YouTube video, kindly go and see this DMA controller topic. Now today is this one, that is DMA transfer. DMA transfer, in this, let us continue, because already we've seen the figure here. So now let us continue this. CPU communicates with DMA to the address and data buses as with any interface unit. This is the point number one under DMA transfer. CPU communicates with the DMA to the address and data buses as with any interface unit. This interface unit, you have to recollect the very first figure where that every I/O device has got an interface unit. Through interface unit, CPU was communicating through I/O bus there. So likewise, this CPU communicates with DMA to this address and data buses as with any interface. The way this communicates to the interface unit as shown in the earlier slides, likewise this to DMA also is communicating through address and data. Very simple, there shouldn't be any confusion. So the DMA has its own address, which activates the DS. DS means, yesterday we have seen DMA select and register select lines. So through that, this is DMA is addressed. The CPU initializes the DMA through the data bus. Once the DMA receives start control command, it can start the transfer between peripheral device and memory. So after initializing, what is initializing? Yesterday we have seen it under DMA controller. So once this initialization is done, meaning if CPU has released the control of those memory bus, of that memory bus. So now what it does is, finally after releasing the bus control, the CPU, then it sends the final start control command to this DMA. DMA receives the start control command from the CPU. From there onwards, this DMA will form a communication between memory and I/O device. When the peripheral device sends a DMA request, the DMA controller activates the BR line. You know BR line, the bus request line. So when peripheral device sends a DMA request, this one we have seen somewhere here, this one. DMA request. Yesterday, I pointed here, this arrow should have been, this arrow should have been the opposite way here, because IO device is requesting DMA. So that's why it should start from here and go to here, this arrow. And once this is this DMA is accepting this request, DMA will be conveying to this IO device through this signal, that is DMA acknowledge, meaning this arrow, pointed arrow, should be here, this side. That's the correction. Everyone make a note of this. So now that is the point here, somewhere we talk about. So the start control and the BR, that is a bus request, this BR. So peripheral device sends a DMA request. The DMA controller activates the BR line, informing the CPU to release, relinquish the buses. The CPU responds with its BG line, that is bus grant line, informing the DMA that its buses are disabled. The DMA then puts the current value of its address register into the address bus, initiates the read or write signal, and sends a DMA acknowledge to the peripheral device. So this everything, just now I have shown you, earlier also several times you have seen this one. If you have any queries, you can ask. Note that read and write lines in the DMA controller are bidirectional. This also we have seen, bidirectional there. The direction of transfer depends on the status of the BG line, meaning this, if you see bus grant, when BG is zero, the read and write are input lines allowing the CPU to communicate with the internal DMA registers. This DMA register, inside DMA there are registers. If CPU wants to check them, read them, and there is no bus request from the IO device, so then definitely there will not be a bus grant to the DMA. So at that time, bus grant will be zero, and this read and write are input lines allowing the CPU to communicate with the internal DMA registers. At this stage, when BG is zero, there is no IO request. That is the point. That's why BG is zero. When BG is one, meaning bus request took place from the IO device and the DMA has requested the CPU to grant the bus control, that's the reason why BG is one. That is bus grant. The read and write are output lines from DMA controller to the random access memory to specify the read and write operation of the data. So this time, in this case, if you see read and write are input lines, but here if you see read and write are output lines, so they are going from DMA controller to the random access memory. Earlier between CPU and DMA, there is no point of this random access memory, just because BG, bus grant, is zero. Since bus grant is zero, it means there is no request from the IO device. That's why bus grant is not enabled. When bus grant is not enabled, who is having the control over the memory bus? CPU having the control over the memory bus. So that's why here BG is zero and read write are input lines. They are behaving like input lines, allowing CPU to communicate with internal DMA registers. At this stage, why it is communicating with the DMA when there is no IO request? Meaning CPU sometimes wants to check the DMA internal registers if there are any. For that reason, it may be, or simply it wants, unless some data been kept and the bus grant is made zero, because this is through interrupt, it might have acknowledged this DMA interrupt signal. Also, you have seen in last session, today, yesterday session. So this DMA has might have communicated through interrupt to the CPU that there are no more to transfer from the IO. So the last one, possibly the left one in the DMA register, that CPU may wants to take. That's why this CPU is communicating to the DMA, and DMA is not communicating to the random access memory. these two are communicating. There is no picture of random access memory here. So simply in this case, BG is zero. The moment BG is becoming one, meaning bus grant, meaning bus request took place already from the IO device to the DMA. And DMA already requested to release, relinquish that bus control, that memory control, memory bus. So that bus request has done by the DMA controller already with the CPU. So CPU has sent a signal called BG, that is bus grant one. Since bus grant one has come to the DMA, meaning CPU has released the memory bus control. Who is having the control now? DMA is having the control over that memory bus. So meaning what? Now DMA can read from that memory, that is random access memory, or DMA can write to random access memory. So reading or writing, now the signals are actually from the DMA. They are going from the DMA. That's why this read and write are output lines from DMA. So when the peripheral device receives a DMA acknowledge, it puts a word in the data bus for write or receives a word from the data bus for read. This is very obvious. For read means it is reading from the random access memory, meaning it obviously receiving from the data bus. If it wants to write, that is IO device wants to write, meaning it wants to put data where? Inside this random access memory. So these things are going to happen when the peripheral device receives DMA acknowledge. Maybe write operation may happen or maybe read operation may happen only when DMA acknowledge signal has been received by the IO device. Thus the DMA controls the read or write operations and supplies the address for the memory. So this is very quite obvious. It has been said already here. The same point here, differently we are saying. The peripheral unit can then communicate with memory through the data bus for direct transfer between the two units while CPU momentarily disabled. So this one also you have seen from this figure. Where is that? This one. In this figure now, this is the data bus. This one, you see the data bus. So once this DMA acknowledge, arrow is here. Remember again, the arrow is not this side, arrow is this side. So when this DMA acknowledge has come, now this IO device can directly talk to this random access. At that point, who is not having control over this bus? These are the buses, data bus, address bus, write, control, put together is a memory bus. So this entire control is by DMA now. This CPU is not having any control over this bus. That's the point. So that is the point here. If you see here, the peripheral unit can then communicate with memory through the data bus for direct transfer between two units, while the CPU is momentarily disabled. So this is said in the last session, not yesterday, day before yesterday, I guess, that taking the paint, if it was doing a task one, then if the task one needs some data from the memory, then CPU cannot access that memory. So for that momentarily, this is disabled just because it cannot access that memory bus. Memory bus is controlled by another DMA. But if there are tasks, task 2 is there, which is not memory dependent, then CPU can attend that task. So that's the point. So for each word that is transferred, the DMA increments its address register, decrements its word count register. This has come yesterday, so I'm not going to further discuss this one. If the word count doesn't reach zero, the DMA checks the request line coming from the peripheral. This also yesterday we have discussed. There are three registers inside. One is the address register, the other is the word count register, the other is the control register. So when this word count is becoming zero, it means what? There are no more that are coming from the IO device, peripheral device. Not coming or peripheral not required. So because it's a memory communication, either if peripheral wants to write to or read from. So that depends upon the word count here. If word count is zero, then no problem. But if it is not zero, then DMA checks the request line coming from the peripheral. Is that clear at this point? So for a high speed device, the line will be active as soon as the previous transfer is complete. There are high speed devices. Then this is without much waiting. This is very quickly, this request line is going to be active. So transfer will continue. But what happens is a second transfer is then initiated and the process continues until the entire block is transferred. This is related to the speed high speed devices. But if the peripheral device is slower, the DMA request line may come somewhat later. This slower and faster example we took some 2 days ago or 3 days ago session. Some 8 bytes to transfer, some time it will take. 1 byte to transfer, how much time it will take? Then so much of time, that is 10,000 microseconds, I guess. It has to wait that CPU. Sort of same is applicable with DMA also. DMA, if a peripheral device is slower, the DMA obviously has to wait for the signal, for the request to come from the peripheral. So in this case, the DMA disables the bus request. So because the memory bus for a moment it can disable bus request from the CPU, because CPU can get hold of the memory bus, because this peripheral is slower. Since this peripheral is slower, we don't know how, at what time again the request may come to the DMA. Instead waiting, this DMA, what it does, it simply releases the bus control of that memory and it gives to the CPU. So CPU can continue to execute its program. When the peripheral request say transfer, this peripheral request is coming to the DMA, it's slower case, then the DMA again it can request. There is no confusion here. Is that clear? If the word count register reaches zero, the DMA stops any further transfer and removes its bus request. So word count means this, you know, yesterday we have seen how much 64 to 128. How many? Let us say 64. 64 to 128. 64 words it has to transfer. Which one? Peripheral device. So that count will be sitting into the word count register. So the moment word count register is going to zero, it means what? The peripheral has done with that request. That's why DMA, what it does, the moment word count becomes zero, it simply releases this control over that bus. So DMA stops any further transfer and removes its bus request. This bus request is going to the all the time to the CPU. CPU is granting the bus request, BG. This is BR. So since not required anymore, so it stops the bus request, meaning that bus grant BG will become zero. So at that time when BG has become zero, the control has gone to the CPU now. It also informs the CPU of the termination by means of an interrupt. Not only this bus request is removing, it is also through interrupt it is conveyed. When the CPU responds to the interrupt, it reads the content of the word count register. CPU also, apart from DMA reading this word count, CPU also reading extra care. This is extra care taken. The zero value of this register indicates that all words were transferred successfully. Earlier I was talking about when BG bus request is not going to CPU, this CPU will be sending BG zero. At that time, CPU will be reading DMA registers. So these sort of registers. At that time, I was telling just today in today's session when we started just some time ago. So why CPU reads DMA register? For this reason, it reads that when bus request is disabled, meaning now CPU will send BG zero, and in addition, bus request removed, CPU is also getting interrupt from the DMA telling that there are no more. So for that, BG is zero, that is bus grant is zero, and then CPU also reading this word count register which is there in the DMA. This is a part of the DMA register. Hope things are clear. This part when I was talking earlier here somewhere about BG zero, this one BG zero, read write are input lines allowing the CPU to communicate with the internal DMA register. This part has come here. This one. When the CPU responds to the interrupt, it reads the content of the word count register. So the zero value of this register indicates that all words were transferred. The CPU can read this register at any time to check the number of words already transferred. So this is also, again, not only whether it's zero, in between also sometimes we are checking whether all words are yet to transfer or needs to be transferred. Needs to end the transfer. So for that, this is checking. So this is the conclusion, I guess, DMA transfer, yes. So a DMA controller may have more than one channel. In this case, each channel has a request and acknowledged pair of control signals, which are connected to separate peripheral devices. Each channel also has its own address register and word count register within the DMA controller. This point I don't know to how many it is, people have got this. This one, you have your, it is your DMA. So we have shown there in some figure, we have here CPU and we have here RAM. Address line, some data line, address line, and some other read and write, all these together are memory bus. So these bus, this one also having control, this one also having control over that, that is your CPU, and this one is also having control over this process, ODM. Now in our presentation, what we said is one I/O device, let us say, this is one channel. So this is a CH1, channel one. So channel one is requesting. Related to this channel one, there will be three registers inside this DMA. One is a word count register, the other is address register, the other is data register. So we have word count register, data register, and address register. Related to, all these are related to channel one. If there is another I/O device, so this is the channel. Even this needs to request a DMA. So related to this channel 2, we will be having all this set. Which set is this entire set? The entire set will be there even for channel 2. Likewise, you can assume here channel 3, channel 4, like that. So that's what the point here, this one. This one is, the DMA controller may have more than one channel. In this case, each channel has a request and acknowledge. Both are there. You have seen in that earlier figure, I would said that this arrow would have been the other side, so that one. So this each channel will have that request and of control signal, which are connected to a separate peripheral device. This separate peripheral, just now in paint we have shown. Each channel also has its own address register, word count register within the DMA controller. This also we have shown in the paint now, just a while ago. A priority among the channels may be established so that channels with a high priority are serviced before channels with a lower priority. Now the issue comes when these are there here. This here. Several channels are like that becoming here. There is another channel here. There is another channel means another I/O device. So, like that, there are several. So now, who should be given the priority? This may be given number one priority, and this may be given number second priority. Likewise, this priority is again the another issue again. So this we have to set. How do you manage this? The priority. How do you manage? Because it may be a simple keyboard request. But it may be some fire engine alarm that is going to the DMA and the CPU immediately should turn off some temperature control, something. This sort of request. So this is something terrible. This needs to be controlled. Otherwise, some blast may occur. CPU is automated. CPU is actually controlling that temperature and all. So programmed, it's automated. There is a form here. This form is automated and controlled by this CPU. The temperature should not exceed 60 degree Celsius. This is giving the feedback, temperature feedback to this through this IO device to this DMA. When temperature exceeds the 60 degrees, the immediately this should be given a priority instead of a keyboard or some other you plug in device, something pen drive or camera. Instead all this should be given the highest priority so that DMA can immediately alert the CPU and CPU can immediately take some action. So such things. So that is the priority setting. So that's the point here. And that question comes when the channels are increasing here. When channels are increasing, this priority issue will come into the picture. A priority among the channels may be established so that channels with high priority are serviced before channels with lower priority. DMA transfer is very useful in many applications. These are a few listed. It is used for fast transfer of information between magnetic disk and memory. It is also useful for updating the display in an interactive terminal. Typically, an image of the screen display of the terminal is kept in memory, which can be updated under program control. The contents of the memory can be transferred to the screen periodically by means of DMA transfer. So this DMA transfer related application, these are the few listed, but you have to remember if this is a part of the DMA transfer. In the examination specifically write about DMA applications, possibilities are there. Question may come like that for 3 marks or 4 marks like that. So in such cases, if you remember this, and so far what all we have discussed, that the DMA is controlling the memory bus. That way CPU is allowed to do some other tasks which are not memory dependent. That also I said orally, do you remember? So such things as a part of DMA applications you can write. So but that is possibilities are there. We cannot deny in external exam, write about DMA applications. So this figure you have seen. Now comes into the picture another topic, that is input output processor. So how many are there this summer? Very few. If you go to this IO input output processor, examination point of view, this is also equally important. If you see the previous year question papers, write about the following. Write about the any two from the following. So among them, some three will be given. One is the DMA, one is the IOP, the other is maybe handshaking protocol, something like that. So among these three, two you have to write. So likewise, this is also having weight in examination point of view. So IO processor, that is input output processor. Instead of having each interface communicate with the CPU, a computer may incorporate one or more external processors and assign them the task of communicating directly with all I/O devices. This point is very straightforward. We have seen several times. The ultimate goal is CPU needs to be allowed to do some computational task rather data transfer jobs. This data as a part of releasing CPU from the data transfer job. Earlier seen that DMA itself is the one example, one hardware that is. Other than that DMA, there is something upgraded one called IO processor. This is also doing the job of DMA only. DMA, what it is doing? DMA releasing the CPU from the job of data transfer that is taking place from IO to memory or memory to IO. Who is doing that job? DMA was doing. So the same job now we are emphasizing with a bit upgraded job, bit upgraded hardware, upgraded than DMA. That is IO processor. So this statement is telling that the same point that instead of having each interface communicate with CPU, a computer may incorporate one or more external processors and assign them the task of communicating directly with all I/O devices. An IOP, that is input-output processor, may be classified as a processor with the direct memory access, DMA capability, that communicates with I/O devices. Got this? The same thing again. The upgraded hardware, I/O input-output processor, may be classified as a processor with the DMA capability. So I/O inside, what is the DMA capability is there that communicates with I/O devices. Other than if DMA capability is there, then what additional I/O may be having? That is the point to learn in this topic. So that we will see shortly now. In this configuration, the computer system can be divided into memory unit and a number of processors comprised of the CPU and one or more IOPs. This you have seen in a previous picture, memory unit and your CPU and the DMA you have seen, where here is your processor, this is your memory unit. And this time, this IOP processor talking about instead of DMA, IOP processor, one or more IOP processors. In IOP processors topic, we are not talking about DMA. We are talking about IOP processor, and this IOP processor is capable of having this DMA, job, DMA ability. So meaning what? In IOP, say let us say this is IOP. Inside this IOP, this hardware is also incorporated. If this is incorporated inside this IOP, what additional this IOP might have? Because what is the point of incorporating? That's the point that we are trying to explore in this topic. So the point that I'm making here is, in this configuration, the computer system can be divided into memory unit. We have seen a while ago just now, the number of processors comprised of CPU and one or more IOP. Each IOP takes care of input and output tasks, relieving the CPU from housekeeping chores involved in I/O transfers. This chores can be, confusions can be avoided. What confusions? Housekeeping confusion. Who is doing this housekeeping? Housekeeping means data transfer. Who is doing earlier? CPU. So this can be avoided with the help of this IOP. Again, I am telling you time and again, earlier we were talking about DMA, now we are talking about IOP. So what is the difference? Shortly will come to know about. The processor that communicates with the remote terminals over telephone and other communication media in a serial fashion is called data communication processor. There is a example just given for IOP processor. The processor that communicates with the remote terminals over telephone. See, currently I am communicating with you people possibly over telephone line. So it's a remote. I am remote and there your terminal is also a remote. So we two remote terminals. Mine is a remote terminal and yours is their remote terminal. So who is helping us to communicate over telephone line? There is a one hardware. That hardware is a communication media. How it is allowing us to communicate in a serial fashion. My everything is going in not in parallel. What all I am communicating going serially, and there at your delivery point it is again parallel. It's converted to parallel. So serial fashion is called data communication processor. It is there with the my service provider, maybe my service provider idea, that BSNL, that fellow will have somewhere nearer to my wires are going from my home to nearer to office. And nearer to office, so there are a lot of hardware involved in that office. So there some processors will be there. Similarly, your remote terminal may be communicating to Jio, suppose. Jio some nearer there, some office will be there. So those office, inside that office, if you ever go visit, there are a lot of hardware involved. So that hardware involved, one example is this data communication processor is one hardware. So this is a sort of example for that. So now, the IOP is similar to the CPU, except that it is designed to handle the details of I/O processing. So this CPU job is to compute, and this job is to handle the I/O processes. Unlike DMA controller, that must be set up entirely by the CPU. Earlier, who was setting the DMA controller? That is, a bus grant request is going from the DMA, and bus request is going from the DMA, and the bus grant is coming from the CPU. And CPU meanwhile also checking that registers of the DMA, that word count register is zero or not. Sometimes CPU also checking. So meaning what? CPU 100% is not relieved from this I/O process. 95% might have been relieved from doing that I/O processing task. CPU 95%, but 5% still it is doing. Like it has to grant bus grant to the DMA, and then interrupt comes from the DMA. Then it has to take over that bus memory, bus control. Such activity is still happening by the CPU. So the point that this IOP is to release 100% this CPU. How it is releasing and all, that's let us see. So the IOP can fetch and execute its own instruction. This is the mechanism. How it is doing is, this is provided with extra capability, like the way it is said, it is similar to CPU, except that it is designed to handle the I/O process. So designed to handle I/O processing means it is provided with extra features, like it can fetch, it can execute its own instructions. So here in this case, what was happening in DMA case, DMA request was actually going to the CPU. CPU momentarily stopping the task it was doing, and it was releasing that bus control to the DMA. And DMA, when it is starting transfer of the data, once in a while, sometimes according to the program that is there, it is CPU also checking the word count of the DMA, whether it's completely zero, so that I can get hold of that memory bus. That activity still CPU is still doing. Maybe 5% it is doing, but it is doing. So, but the point here is, this IOP processor is completely independently, it can make a decision without banking on the CPU. Now CPU will not bother about releasing the bus control and all. This IOP is just like a CPU. It is making a decision. It is having its own fetch and execute its own instructions, that capability to handle this I/O process. So at that time, CPU will not play a role. So IOP instructions are specifically designed to facilitate I/O transfers. So that is how this is planned. In addition, IOP can perform other processing tasks such as arithmetic, logic, branching, and code translation. So these are the additional capabilities. Earlier, so far, I was telling what was the difference then. If this IOP is simply, is also embedded with DMA. Simply embedded doesn't bring any special features to the IOP. So let us see in subsequent slides what those special features are. So those are the special features. Special features are, this IOP can fetch and execute its own instruction, point number one. These instructions are specifically designed to facilitate I/O transfers, this is point number two. Point number three is, IOP can perform other processing other than this I/O transfers. It also can do arithmetic, logic, the way CPU, as I said, I was telling you, it was a computation. Main intention is to compute. So the compute is this arithmetic logic. So those activities also this IOP can do. Got the point? So the block diagram of computer with the two processes is shown here in the figure 6. Let us see what is the figure 6. This is figure 6. You see the figure 6. This is a memory bus. This memory bus is, you see the two arrows here. Your CPU is also communicating to the memory bus. Your IOP is just like CPU, it is also communicating to the memory. Just like. But all these peripheral devices, PD, peripheral devices, are connected to this I/O. So then you may have a doubt then when CPU is actually accessing this bus. How is that possible for IOP to access this bus? The time management, there are a lot many things to learn, but it's not part of the syllabus. Say, time division multiplexing or something you might have heard like that. The time based, like, you know, this census, if bus is free, then it will access you. If bus is busy with CPU, then for a while it possibly may delay. So that thing still happens, but CPU will not involve here now. This CPU will not involve, like DMA, it was involving, no? It is taking a request actually from the, let us say this is DMA. What was happening? It is requesting here to the through that what called BR bus request. Then CPU is communicating this DMA through BG bus grant. And then once this is acknowledging the devices here. Once this here registers are there inside, address register, that word count register, and some register, what is that? Control register. CPU also checking here. So CPU involvement was there in the DMA, but here now CPU involvement will not be there. Independently, this IOP is making a decision, everything. Like this is requesting some memory here, 64 to 128. This is so capable that without this asking the CPU, this IOP makes a decision. It goes there 64 to 128, it accesses the block completely. Whichever device it is asking, it will give it to that. If it wants to write 64 to 128 for the location, then without asking CPU, it can go here and it can write. The only point here to understand is this glitch. The glitch is at the time when CPU accessing this bus, can this write or read? That's the glitch. So this glitch is handled through time mechanism, time-based mechanism. Like, you know, for 1 nanosecond, this one, and the other nanosecond, this one. Like that, they keep communicating. That glitch is still there. So in the future, you can work as your project, and that glitch you can avoid, and you can present your paper in the IEEE journal. So that is really seriously I'm talking. So that is there still. So there we are. Where here? Figure 6. The memory unit occupies the central position and can communicate with each processor by means of direct memory access. The memory unit occupies central position and can communicate with each processor by means of direct memory access. This direct memory access is there in the IOP now. The CPU is responsible for processing data needed in the solution of computational tasks. This is known to you. The IOP provides a path for transfer of data between various peripheral devices and memory. This is also known to you. Just now we have seen. The CPU is usually assigned a task of initiating the IO program, input output. This is something that we are we did not talk while we had gone to this figure 6. CPU usually, this time management, we talked about this. CPU, what is that happening? CPU is usually assigned the task of initiating the IO program. If there is an IO program, input output program, CPU generally initializes means if there is a query here, so this query, this peripheral device is trying to access this memory. This CPU has the authority. This about the glitch, I talked about the glitch. So that glitch, like how to, who should go first here to access this one, and whether this to be permitted first to go and access, and then it can postpone for a while, this glitch, this access bus. So that is, that decision making is left with the CPU. So that is what the point is. This one. The CPU is usually assigned the task of initiating the IOP. From then on, IOP operates independent of the CPU and continues to transfer data from external devices and memory. So now the data formats of peripheral devices differ from memory and CPU data format. This long ago we have seen when the first figure, each interface has, you know, every IO device has got an interface unit. Why? Because data formats are differing. So this is the same point, this one. If you have any queries, you can ask, but I'm just skipping. The reason is already it has come. The IOP must structure data words from many different sources. This is the aim of this version. For example, it may be necessary to take 4 bytes from the input device and pack them into 132-bit word before the transfer to memory. This is the same link to this. And though this has been discussed earlier, the very first figure, why we need that interface units, meaning this IOP is capable of upgraded, means it is possessing the ability of now interface unit module hardware. The first figure what we have seen, the second the DMA hardware, so and CPU abilities like arithmetic and logical functionalities performing. So this IOP is so sophisticated, means so advanced. Okay, so the data are gathered in the IOP at the device rate and the bit capacity while the CPU is executing its own program. This also known to you why this interface is required. So peripherals may be slower, CPU may be faster. That's why interface unit needs to have some data registers inside, so that it can put inside that data register the slower device. This faster device can come and pick them. So like that we discussed, the data rate issues. So that speed issues, data rate means how fast it can transfer. So those are also capable. So after the input data are assembled into the memory board, they are transferred from IOP directly into the memory by stealing one memory cycle from the CPU. This is what the thing I convey to you people, that stealing means for a while, Baba, you do it. For 1 nanosecond, you do it. And the other 1 nanosecond, you just keep quiet. I will do the job. That is the stealing. Stealing one memory cycle. So similarly, an output word transferred from memory to the IOP is directed from the IOP to the output device at the device rate and bit capacity. So with this, these are three more slides. Here we completed. These three you can grab this. The communication between the IOP and the devices attached to it is similar to the program control method of transfer communication with the memory. It's similar to the direct memory access method. This is the same again. That's what I just want to skip this. The reason why, because the communication between the IOP and the devices, that is the peripheral devices attached to it, is similar to the program control method. This program control method we have seen data transfer, we have seen that program control method is there, IO versus memory and memory mapped method, three methods we have seen. So in that program control method is there, program control method. Are you remembering, guys, any confusion? Program control method. Previously, we have talked about transfer, three methods are there. One is the programmed control method, the other is IO versus memory, the other is only memory map. Remembering? Guys, there, remembering? Hey, no one responding. Someone unmute and respond. We're about to wrap this session quickly. Someone unmute and respond. Are you people there? Hey, what happened? Guys, are you people there? Are no one responding? What happened?
Yes, sir.
Okay, Baba, you can respond to somebody. Is that clear at this point what I was telling? This program control method. Someone respond so that I can proceed. Simply unmute and tell yes or no, what is the problem? Is that clear?
Sir.
Okay. Why then you people are so much hesitating to respond? Are you resting or what? So that's the point here. The way by which the CPU and IOP communicate depends on the level of sophistication. This is the advancement. How much sophisticated this device? Sophisticated means how much advanced the technology. So the way by which the CPU and the IOP communicate depends on the level of advancement included in the system. Sophistication included in the system. Sophistication means advancement included in the system. So in very large scale computers, each processor is independent of all others, and any one processor can initiate an operation. This is again the same story here, that this one. So who will initiate somewhere where is the similar lane with that? This one. The CPU usually assigns the task of initiating the IO program. So the same point here. In a very large scale computer, each processor is independent of all others, and any one processor can initiate an operation. So that is the, in most computer systems, the CPU is the master, while IOP is the slave processor. In most computers, this is the, that is what stealing about who will take over that, you know, 1 nanosecond you and the other nanosecond I. Who will go first? So that is actually given that opportunity to decide to the CPU, not to the IOP. So the CPU is assigned the task of initiating all operations, but IO instructions are executed in the IOP only. So this is also already discussed. So let us wrap up on today's session, because again, if I take, go these 4 points, the 4 points will be the same.